advised.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to start very shortly as a couple more come in. There's plenty of, as always is the case, guess what? The front row's almost empty. It's really the second row. We took the first row out, so you don't be embarrassed about coming right down to the front, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, let's get underway, because we have a really full day for you here today, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to CEO Connect for August. My name's Ian Irvine, and I'm very pleased to be your host and MC for today's proceedings. But to begin, before we start, I'd like to acknowledge that this event is being held on the traditional lands of the Gadigal people, and I pay my respects to elders past and present. As many of you would know, and I've seen plenty of familiar faces from earlier CEO Connect sessions, today's session provides you an opportunity to hear from ASX-listed chief executive officers talk about their businesses. Each presentation runs for around about 15 minutes in a formal sense, and then if time permits, up to 20 minutes, beyond the 15, another five, there's an opportunity for a couple of quick questions. If we do take questions and time permits, please wait for the microphone to come to you, because as you may have seen, today's event is being recorded and videoed, and we want everyone to hear what the questions are. My role today is really easy. All I've got to do is keep everything on time. No small challenge there, given that CEOs of their own businesses are somewhat impassioned about their business. But before I start, I need to advise you of a couple of changes to our agenda. As you came in, you will have received an additional brief on a couple of companies, Elmo Software and Metrics Opportunities Income Trust. They have been able to help us fill a gap which was created, unfortunately, by the inability of ERM Power to present today at, I think, their scheduled time, 11:40. Their CEO, John Stretch, is most apologetic and does so profusely apologise for not being here today. But I think, as we all understand, the pressures of business are as they are. So, we may be one short, but we've got two extra presenters for you today. So, a bonus, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, we will hear, as I mentioned, from Elmo CEO Danny Lessman, who will talk to us at 11 o'clock, my mistake, not 11:40. And we've added an additional slot at 12 o'clock today, which means we'll finish 20 minutes after our schedule finished at around about 12:20 today. I think it will be worth your while to stay the distance, and I'd encourage you to do so. Just a quick look at our agenda, subject to those revisions. Firstly, we're going to hear from Alan Oster at NAB, our co-partner in these events, which is really great, to set the scene. Then Mirvac, Cleanaway, Elmo will replace ERM Power, Lendlease, Telstra, and then finally Metrics Credit Partners. Metrics may be of interest to many of us in the room who may be concerned about low interest rates. They're an income fund, that a number of which have listed recently on the exchange, and they're providing investors with an opportunity to consider alternatives to putting your money in a bank in a term deposit. So I shouldn't say that with NAB in the room, should I? But I'm fairly certain it's all on our minds. So without further ado, it's my pleasure to hand over to our first presenter, Alan Oster from NAB. Alan would be known to many of us. The other good piece of news is you hear a lot inside your brochure today with that little addendum. You'll be able to find out a lot more information about the companies that are presenting here today. So, as I said, without further ado, over to you, Alan, to take us through. And here's your 20 minutes update from NAB. Not much going on in the global economy these days, is there?
No, not much at all. Thanks very much. Okay, so you guys are going to get the slide pack. And what I'm going to do is, because I've only got 15 minutes, I'm going to jump through a number of slides. But the first slide I'm going to put up is sort of a summary slide. Lots of words, but let me sort of take you through it. First thing you need to know is the global economy is slowing. And that's a general thing. It's very much trade related. It also seems to be related to technology. Particularly in Europe and Japan, you've got issues. You're going to have, Germany is almost certainly going to have a recession. Well, it's got half of it a recession, and it's sort of not getting any better. From an Australian point of view, the main thing that matters in the globe is what's happening in the US and what's happening in China. The US is slowing, and tariffs are likely to slow growth a bit further. However, the other thing that's also happening is policy makers are aware of that. And so you're going to see big changes in interest rates. So I'll show you a slide in a minute in the Fed that they previously had expected that rates would go currently 2.25. They thought it was going to 3.25. It's now on its way to 1. All right? And so you see the same sort of issue in China. My comment about China would be we think it's okay. Australia's in a really good position in the sense that if the Chinese stimulate their economy, what will happen will be is they'll need fiscal policies, they'll need iron ore, coal, things like that. The only thing you'd get worried about is if essentially China and the US manage to kill each other. Then we're in deep trouble. But outside of that, it's not that bad. I'll talk a little bit more about the Australian economy. For me, the critical issue is the consumer. And what we're seeing in the consumer is not a lot of wages growth, and I'll talk a little bit about that later, but consumers then having to spend on things that they think they desperately need. So think utility prices, think health, think education. They will do that. Anything else, they won't do. So if they've got any discretion, that's what they're going to do. And that just slows the whole economy. The other thing that's really important is as the house prices go down, one of the main effects is people essentially stop building new houses and new apartments and they go out and do renovations, which takes out the white good industries as well. However, having said that, there are other parts of the economy that are really doing well. And the other parts of the economy that are doing very well are the public sector. So you're in Sydney, you know about the new airport. If you're in Melbourne, they're digging half of Melbourne up. And so the railway lines don't work. My local line was out for a month. Now it's out again each weekend. And they're just continuing to build huge amounts. We're now the largest exporter of LNG in the world. And we finally finished all our construction of platforms. And they're now in a situation where, whilst they're not employing anybody, they're probably not making any money, but it's counted for GDP. And so those sort of things mean that you've got a private sector, public sector split that is different. So for us, we still see GDP improving to something around 2%, maybe 2.25%. The RBA is more like 2.75%. And so for us, we don't see wages getting any better. We don't see the consumer feeling any happier. And that then sort of says, well, what can they do? And for us, at least one more rate cut. Our sort of official view is one more rate cut in November and then they'll move to non-traditional monetary stimulus. It could well be, when you hear the RBA talk, what they're really going to do is two more rate cuts and then conditional. What they really need, though, is they really need fiscal policy. And I'll talk a little bit about that because what we've had so far is very little. Okay, so I'm going to quickly move through some of these slides. And I've probably taken 5 minutes on my first slide, so my other 20 are not going to go through very quickly. So that's just showing the global slowdown. That's showing what the Fed, in red is what the Fed's already done, and in black is what the Fed's going to do. So if I move on a little bit, I won't talk about numbers. Currency, we have the currency. We think it's worth about 68 at present, plus or minus 5 cents. To the extent that Trump continues to sort of stir up uncertainty, we could see the Australian dollar going to 65, and then we have it sort of recovering. The Fed is going to cut a lot more than the Australian Reserve Bank. All right, so a couple of things about where the economy's at. This is business confidence. It's important in terms of dynamics. The sort of red dotted line through the middle there, that's basically saying long run average. So confidence is a bit below average, but not terribly. What's really important is not confidence, but how is business going? And what we see, same graph, et cetera, not confidence, but how did you go? Employment, et cetera. So you're either a glass half full person or a glass half empty person with this slide. Okay, so what it's done is it's saying there's a hell of a lot of momentum has been taken out of the Australian economy in the private sector. If you're glass half full, it's not that bad. What I'd also say, however, is it really matters as to what you are. So if you're in a discretionary retail, you're down at minus 25 in trend terms, and in original terms or seasonally adjusted terms, you're down at minus 32. Minus 32 is worse than anything we've had since 1990. So this is, I don't care what they say, as far as I'm concerned, discretionary retail is essentially in recession. Okay. There's been some big slowing in manufacturing, and it's starting also to affect general services as well. Okay. People say, oh, well, the survey might not be that great. This is an interesting graph in the sense that all I'm trying to show you here, red is private sector, grey is public sector. It's very rare that you basically see red down the bottom. So we've had it in the GFC, and we've had it around 2000, for people who might not be aware that 2000 was a major global recession. So it's not that great. One of the things the politicians probably don't tell you is, yeah, we know there's 350,000 jobs being created in the last 12 months or thereabouts. Only about 50,000 of that 350,000 is in the private sector. Most of them are in the public sector. And that, again, you don't hear very often. Going to move on. Okay, so fiscal policy, monetary policy. What I do, I used to run the forecasting area of the Australian Treasury. So what I do is I put a model in there, and I'm assuming there's three rate cuts. And it says that after about 12 months, you might get 0.8% growth increase. So it sort of helps, but it's next year's help. Fiscal policy, $7.5 billion worth of tax refunds, okay? Sounds a lot. Except I'll tell you, the economy is $2.5 trillion. It's worth about 0.1%. And from the data we've got internally, we're doing a lot of internal data, people seem like, so far anyway, have been spending about 15, maybe 20%. No more. The assumption was they'd spend 50%. So that 0.1% is probably over-egging it a bit. I might move then on to, this is a graph that sort of tries to explain what people are actually spending their money on. So if you're on the zero line, it basically says you're spending the same amount as you did last year or last quarter. If you go up, you're spending more. So that's utilities. That's paying off debt. And one thing we've seen already is when you have your rate cut, consumers do not automatically lower their repayments. Most of them continue on. And the blue line is a little bit more, so what's that? That's like transport, food, medical, children. The red line's the rest, and that's the problem. Last thing I'd sort of say, be fairly quick. Wages, we can explain why wages have come down. Part of the story, but we can't explain why they haven't gone back up yet. Part of the story is inflation's low, productivity's low, so if you're an employer, you're giving away your profit. The other thing is the labour market's much slacker than you think it is. So, very quickly, the unemployment rate's about 5.3, right? If I add on those who are basically saying, it's too hard, I can't find a job, I've given up, and or I'm working 12 hours instead of 40 hours, which is really important, you get something called the underutilisation rate, which is 13.5%. And the gap between the two in the grey line here is higher than any period since 1980. So we don't see this changing in any fundamental sense. I know you want to talk about house prices, so I'll very quickly... Oh, inflation's really low. That's the other issue. Why in retail everybody's discounting, etc. Online retailing's making it very difficult. A bit of perspective on house prices. My perspective is, so what I've done in this chart is basically saying 2007, we'll put it at 100. There's Sydney, so you're up at a scale of about 150, 200% if you're in Melbourne. The only place that actually has house prices lower than where they were in 2007, and I'm there next week, so that's going to be fun, is Perth. And we see a lot of differences in house prices by suburb, and we look at it by suburb. So I'm going to roll, I'm in Sydney, so I'm going to roll you through a few charts. The reason we look is 1% of postcodes in Australia we don't like. Okay? Why don't we like them? Because unemployment's above 8 and they're defaulting. 1% of postcodes explain 50% of our bad debts. Okay? So that's what we look at. So there's February 2008. Red is bad, by the way. November, May. And if I'm optimistic, I think I can see a little bit more green. And I'm also basically seeing a little bit less of the really red colours. So I'm going to move on a couple of slides and just sort of finalise. Our expectations is you'll get growth of about 0.5. So you hear the paper saying, well, the level of GDP is only 1.5% up on this time last year, and they'll say that's disaster. That's not really, that's what's happened in the past. It's more about what's happening in the future. And the other sort of thing is red is essentially public sector demand. So we expect the private sector demand to pick up a bit. And the public sector to stay strong. So we have some recovery, but not huge. And then that says to us unemployment goes up a little bit, which is the black line, rather than down, which means that you're not running your economy fast enough, and that's why everyone wants to give you wage increases. And so my last comment would be, what do we expect? The markets have already priced essentially the best part of 50 basis points cuts, and we think they'll do at least 25, probably November, and I would not bet against the idea of 50 basis points and then some more stuff in terms of that. So I've done my time. Happy to take questions.
All right. Do we have any questions for Alan? If you can wait till we get a microphone to you.
Hi. In the last GFC, there were state of the banks in US was very bad. Mm-hmm. What do you think will happen this time, and what is the state of the banks in Australia and US?
US had a lot of problems in the GFC, essentially because they'd expanded their lending to households who couldn't afford it, put bluntly, and that then dropped the entire banking system. We don't see that dynamic happen. And in Australia, by the way, that did not happen. So the banks, even though the politicians said, you know, we protected the banks, the big banks anyway, had money coming out of the smaller banks into them. And so the only reason that we sort of went offshore and got a government guarantee was everybody else was guaranteeing the government debt. So the big banks didn't fall over. That's part of the reason we didn't get a problem. To me, you can never say never in terms of the banking system, but this doesn't look like a financial recession that we had in the GFC. And this, in Europe, it's different because they don't have much ammunition. So I sort of talked to Credit Suisse and Swiss Re, and then in Germany, they come out to see me, and they say, what are you guys complaining about? You got 2% growth, you got low inflation, unemployment's not too bad, you got a huge amount of fiscal policy you can use, and you still got positive rates. So it's a very different view. But of course, if something really bad in terms of trade gets involved, then that's another issue.
Okay, time for one more quick one, if there is. If the gentleman, oh, I'll go to the lady, she's closer, sir.
I bet you it's the same question.
Okay, you know, with the expected, you know, rate cut in November, which,
yep,
you know, it's something we look forward to, do you think this time the bank will, the banks will, yep, pass it on? I mean, in order to achieve.
Okay, what so it wants it's, to they will pass some of it through. I know nothing in terms, so this is my sort of economics version, not the NAB version. I don't think they'll fully pass it on, and the reason I don't think they'll fully pass it on is not because funding costs aren't down, they are. The problem is what's called deposit floors. So in other words, you have huge amounts of money that has been, you know, you get less than 0.2 of 1%, so how do you pass on one side of the balance sheet that? And so to give you some sort of feel, I think roughly some internal calculations is if we have those three rate cuts, it would cost the bank, NAB, about $200 million in profit in terms of what we've been doing so far. So the more you start passing it on, or sorry, the more that they cut, the more likely it is that the banks will start doing something else. And that's why you need to do something that doesn't affect the bank's balance sheets, because we won't pass it on, or won't fully pass it on anyway. So it's more about the dynamics of the way the bank is set up rather than the cost of funds in the current environment.
All right, we're going to leave it there, ladies and gentlemen. Why don't we say thank you to Alan?
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Hopefully you all saw our postcodes there in a positive light. Continuing that theme, but just before I do, now that we're all in the room, each one of you should have received a raffle ticket as you came in. Anyone not receive one? There's a gentleman up there. Anyone get two? Sure. As a small consolation, as though getting two extra presentations is not a bonus enough, we'll draw a raffle for a $150 Visa gift card at the end of the session, and the old rules apply. At 12:20, you need to be in the room to win it. So we'll keep going till your number comes up. So, as I say, a small concession, but I would have thought a couple of excellent presentations in addition to the ones that were scheduled will be a bonus for you. Our next presenter is from Mirvac, and I think I can see Brett at the back of the room as he slowly makes his way towards the front. He's going to take us through, as I said, the continuing theme, I guess, a little bit around property. So please join me in welcoming Brett Draffen.
Thank you. Great. Good morning, everyone. Pleasure to be here this morning and to give you a bit of an update of what's happening with Mirvac. So, I'll just quickly start with, I imagine a few of you have some exposure to Mirvac and understanding the brand, but just quickly, what is Mirvac? It's an ASX 40 listed group. It has a long track record around quality. It's been operating for some 47 years. And I think that you'd appreciate that it probably has one of the strongest residential brands around quality. So it's something that we're very passionate about, and it's something that's been hard-earned over many, many years. And I think in this current time where trust is perhaps questionable about what you're seeing happening, particularly in the residential market, I think that track record around quality is increasingly important. In terms of where we play, we principally play in four sectors across four states. So we play in the office and industrial, the retail, and the residential markets, and predominantly Sydney, Melbourne, but also exposures to Brisbane and Perth. In terms of that exposure, you can see here on this slide that some 80% of the group's capital is actually deployed to Sydney and Melbourne as our two core markets. These are the two markets that are, I guess, the deepest markets in Australia. They benefit from the lion's share of population growth, overseas migration, massive infrastructure spend playing out, and they're generally the strongest and deepest markets. So we like to apply about 80% of the group's capital to these markets. And think of Perth and Brisbane for us as probably more tactical markets where we'll look at capital allocation coming in and out based on how we see opportunity. As we currently sit here today, we've got about $22 billion of assets under management. $11.5 billion of that sits in our property trust. So this is the part of the business that is the recurring income stream in our office, retail and industrial areas. And that's about 87% of the group's total capital. So these are the buildings, quality buildings, that largely we've developed ourselves that produce the consistent income from rental, and that's a real strong driver to distribution growth over time. And we have about somewhere between $1.6 and $2 billion worth of capital in our active development business, primarily in residential development, but also in our commercial development opportunities. And now we manage about $8.7 billion of capital for other institutional investors as well. Quite often we partner using our own balance sheet and also institutional capital partners to do the sort of projects that we do. In FY19, we had a very good strong result for the group. You can see the return on invested capital was just over 10%, and that's significantly above the group's weighted average cost of capital. So, you know, very strong performance across the sectors. You can see the breakdown between office, industrial, retail and residential. All good, obviously retail a little bit less, and that does reflect some of the comments you heard in that previous slide, and I'll talk about that a bit more in a minute. But going forward, we target a three-year average return on invested capital of 9% or greater. In terms of FY19, I think you saw a very, very strong result. We delivered at the top end, again, of our EPS and DPS guidance. And you can see on that slide, basically, very, very strong results. And I think, importantly, you can see since FY13, we've been able to demonstrate a very strong continuation. So this is not about a one-year good news story. This is a continuation of a strong growth platform, which is really consistent with the strategy we charted a number of years ago. And why is that so? Well, FY20, the financial we're in now, the pathway to success for this year and ongoing has been charted many, many years ago. You know, properties are a very long-term asset class. And, you know, we made some hard decisions many years ago about getting out of non-core assets that we thought would underperform. And so many years ago, we sold, for example, out of our non-core retail exposures. And you know, I'm sure you'll see it very topical in current times in terms of there's, you know, something in excess of $11 billion worth of retail assets on the market for sale. You know, some of our peers can't sell their assets for book value or less. You know, we made the decision many years ago to exit out of our non-core portfolios, and that set us up very, very well in terms of going forward. Equally, in the residential business, we made decisions to restock the pipeline of our development activities, you know, prior to 2015. And I think we've seen, particularly Sydney, Melbourne, we've seen residential markets very hot over the last 2-3 years. And, you know, we weren't the buyer of residential in the last couple of years. We restocked a number of years ago. We have a very, very strong pipeline with great embedded margins. And equally, you know, we're an urban asset creator. So what we do is we use our development skills to create new product. We don't just buy property assets on market. We use our development skills to create those assets. So we've got a strong pipeline, particularly in our office and industrial business, about buildings that we're under construction, already pre-leased, and when they come online, they will deliver new net operating income, which obviously helps with our earnings and also our distribution growth going forward. And probably now it is timely for us. We do see some opportunities in the residential market, so we are doing some selective restocking in our residential business. But, you know, fortunately, we have some 28,000 lots that we control, so we're not forced to restock, but we are starting to see some interesting opportunities in the market. An important theme for Mirvac is over the last sort of 6-7 years, we've been growing our passive portfolio, particularly in office and industrial. And what that means is now, as I said, 87% of the group's capital is in those recurring income streams. And that's really a strong platform for how we see our ability to continue to deliver strong distribution growth. So we know, for example, right through to beyond, you know, 2023, we've got a number of buildings coming online which are under construction. They're already largely pre-committed and de-risked. And we know that those passive earnings will grow by 5% per annum every year just for what we have under control now. So we're very comfortable we've got the right allocation of capital. And we think, you know, that combination of using our development skills with active capital to create future passive recurring income is the right strategy. So just in terms of some of the opportunities in FY19, we've acquired almost $2 billion worth of opportunities in the office sector, predominantly Sydney, Melbourne. In the residential business, we've restocked an additional 3,000 lots, primarily in very capital efficient structures where we haven't paid for the land all up front. So that's a very efficient use of our balance sheet. And in the industrial business, we've acquired about $1.2 billion worth of industrial assets, primarily in the Sydney market, which is, again, the strongest market in Australia. So we're very comfortable we can continue to use our development skills in a way where we keep creating assets, and that means we don't need to go onto the market and buy those assets at inflated prices. I talked about the strong track record, and I think you can see it in this slide. You know, you can see that the group year in, year out has delivered very, very strong growth, good EPS, good DPS. And as I say, we're very, very confident we can continue to deliver the sort of performance that you see in this in these charts. We heard a bit about debt from the balance sheet. You know, Mirvac's balance sheet is very, very strong. You know, if we think back to the GFC days, you know, the balance sheet now is absolutely rock solid. So our gearing is at just over 20%. You know, our stated gearing range is 20 to 30%, so at the low end of that range. Our average cost of debt is about 4.8%, and by the end of this financial year, that'll be down to about 4.2, 4.3%. So we've got very, very efficient cost of our debt, And you can see there the average debt maturity, 8.5 years. So this is what's very different from the GFC. You know, in GFC, everyone had very short-term debt. Now we've been able to put in some very good long-term borrowings, and you can see the exposure profile in that chart there, that, you know, we've got some debt that goes out, you know, sort of out to FY, you know, 40. So very long dated and a stable credit rating. So the group's balance sheet is probably the strongest I've ever seen. And what that balance sheet means is we're obviously, you know, we're at the low end of our gearing range, which means that we're well placed in terms of headroom to take advantage of future opportunities as well. And I think what you can see there on that chart is, you know, the good thing about Mirvac is it uses its development skills to create assets, as I say, not buying them on market. And you can see here that our distribution is very comfortably covered by our operating earnings. So we're not using any borrowings to fund distribution. The business can continue to demonstrate strong cash flows, which really does drive a very, very strong distribution profile. I think this slide also gives you some idea of sort of the asset creation we've done over the last sort of 4 or 5 years. And you can see here the top bars in that chart are really about how the passive portfolio is created with these new buildings coming online that we've created ourselves. You can see the third party capital line, which is the middle bars there, how that's grown as well. So we're using institutional capital partners to work with as we create those assets. And the dark blue bars, you can see that we keep the amount of active capital, the development capital that's not income producing, we keep it within a very stated band. So that's a very good model for Mirvac, because we think we can continue to do that and continue to grow the passive portfolio over time. I think this slide gives you some idea of that. So this slide gives you basically a number of projects that are under construction now that will be delivered out to 2022. And you can see that those projects, they're predominantly office buildings, and they're in excess of 90% leased already, so already de-risked. We have in-house construction, so we're delivering these buildings ourselves. And when they become complete, they will add about another $90 million worth of net operating income onto, in terms of our earnings. There's about $200 million worth of NTA uplift that will come through over those years, just as those buildings reach practical completion. And there's about $130 million worth of development earnings that we'll recognise over that time. So these are things that we know about, they're in delivery and they're de-risked. So it's just a matter of us delivering these assets, and then that additional earnings comes online. And the other thing, beyond 2023, we have a pipeline of other projects that we're working on now. So, you know, we're very confident that there's always sort of a five-year profile in front of us where we know the future of the group in, you know, a very risk-adjusted way. There was a little bit of discussion in the previous slide from Alan about retail, and certainly we do acknowledge that, you know, the retail sector is challenged. As I said to you, we made a decision many years ago to exit out of some of our non-core retail, and, you know, we sold those assets at above book value many years ago. You know, if we were selling those same assets today, they would be sold at discount to book value. So, you know, we think we made the right call early. And I think what we have been doing is focusing our retail portfolio, which is about $3.4 billion, into urban catchments, predominantly Sydney and Melbourne. You know, catchments where there's densification, there's strong levels of disposable income, there's population coming into those areas. So retail is a challenged sector. You know, I think retail sales growth is the slowest it's been since 1991, and there's both structural and cyclical changes coming through that sector. But it's not all bad, and there are opportunities, and we think we've got a very, very strong portfolio that will continue to perform to our expectations. And you can see what we've done over the last, you know, sort of 3-4 years, we've been remixing our retail portfolio. So, you know, department stores down by 57%, jewellery down by 42%, homewares down by 47%. So we've been getting out of that, you know, discretionary type retail, and we've refocused to food catering, entertainment, and some non-retail uses. And the centres we own are typically inner urban type centres where they're really the hub of the local community, and they're being used for more than just what I'd say a traditional shopping experience. And I think in that regard, you can see on that chart on the left-hand side, you know, we're coming up to a, you know, a generational change in the customer. You know, if you look at that chart, by 2024, you know, the millennials, the Gen Y, Gen Z and Alpha, you know, they will be the most dominant customer going forward. And so the retail offer has to change because these customers are, you know, they're different in terms of their behaviour, in terms of what we've seen before. So we've been very conscious to be ahead of the curve there, and we continue to believe there's a role for retail, and we think retail expertise is very important, particularly when you're looking at mixed-use precincts in capital cities like Sydney and Melbourne. In terms of the residential space, you know, as I said, I think, you know, selfishly, we think Mirvac's got the strongest residential brand. And I think a time now where you're seeing a lot of mixed news around residential, you know, you're seeing developers going broke, you're seeing some purchasers who have lost their deposits and off-the-plan sales, you're seeing Opal Tower-type issues, structural issues, cladding issues. You know, I think this is a good time for Mirvac because 2-3 years ago, everyone was in the same sort of pool in terms of how everyone thought about residential. You know, Mirvac's a trusted brand. It's known for quality. We stand behind our product. And, you know, we think there's actually people are starting to get a better appreciation for, you know, groups that stand behind their product, have a strong brand versus, you know, the average developer, shall we say. So we think it's actually a very good time for Mirvac. And, you know, you'll continue to see us do innovative product. And, you know, we're very proud of the product that we deliver. In terms of restocking, as I said to you, we haven't done a lot of restocking over the last couple of years. We did most of our restocking prior to FY15, as you can see on that slide. And, you know, we're really in a very good position that we've got a strong pipeline. That pipeline was bought many years ago. It's got great embedded margins, so we know there's very strong profitability in the future pipeline. You can see that we've got about 28,000 lots there. And, you know, what we've been doing is we've been remixing slightly to master plan communities away from apartments. So going forward, we'll have a slightly higher percentage there, but a very, very strong position going forward. On the residential market, again, you heard comments in the previous slide. We're pretty similar. We don't see, you know, post-election, there's been a, certainly a recovery in inquiry. We're seeing really FY20 as the opportunity to drive increasing volumes, but we don't really see it as an opportunity to grow price significantly. So recovering, particularly in the established market, but I think FY20 is a period for continuation of slow recovery. Hopefully we can deliver stronger volumes than we're currently guiding to, and we certainly have the projects to go faster if the market is stronger than we think, but we think probably 21 and beyond is more of an opportunity around price. So just finishing up, you know, I think, you know, this reporting season, I think you have seen some very mixed results across the areas in terms of groups that have delivered strong results and groups that have delivered, you know, perhaps some mixed results. And I think from a Mirvac perspective, we have come out again with a strong EPS growth of 3-4% and a very, very strong DPS growth, which is the 5% going forward. And I think hopefully what you've seen in these slides is that we have the capacity to keep creating the product, which creates those earnings, and equally that we have a strong pipeline of which has largely been de-risked already so that we have a high level of confidence that we can continue to deliver the sort of returns that you've seen from us, you know, last year, more recently, and our ability to keep doing that going forward. So with that, happy to take some questions.
I think we have time for one very quick one. Gentlemen, just down here. Gentlemen,
sorry, give you a little bit of a jaunt down there. We're right on time. Just where you are. Oh.
Hi, this is just a general question regarding the residential building problem, which has currently created a lot of uncertainty because of the systemic problem.
Yes.
And that hasn't been quantified, and it hasn't been come up with any new policy to rectify the current impact, existing stock. And as an investor in the share with this, or in property investor in generally,
yes.
Everyone is waiting for things to happen that to move forward. So what's your comment on this?
Yeah, I think this area around building quality, whether it be the cladding, whether it be structural, whether it be certification, you know, I think you're seeing governments respond in some ways. You've seen a response down in Melbourne, as an example.
You've I'm more concerned with the lack of the insurance.
Yeah. I think it is.
That's a big problem.
I agree. I, I, look, I don't think there is any silver bullet fix to this. I think you're seeing governments do incremental things, but this is a very complex area. There is a lot of variability in the industry. You know, you think about there's large development groups, there's very small groups. There's a lot of the process around certification of buildings is quite varied. So I think it's positive that governments are starting to lead in terms of, you know, if you think about in New South Wales, the new building commissioner, for example. But what I would say to you is I think this is a time for you to focus on groups with quality names, track records. You know, I always say when you're buying off the plan, you know, you're buying, as an example, with apartments, you're trusting that developer to deliver a quality product. And I think you should be, you know, I think this is a time where you'll see a bifurcation around quality. Groups that have a track record for delivering that quality will, I think, continue to do well and probably do better than we've seen in the last few years. But I do think it's good that government are now putting the focus on some areas because, you know, the whole industry has probably been tarnished by the lowest common denominator in terms of them doing things that perhaps they shouldn't be doing. So, but there's no silver fix here, but I think there's positive reasons for change.
Okay, unfortunately, we're going to need to leave it there, but let's say thank you to Brett for his introduction to Mirvac for many of us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, our next presenter, I'm told, is at the back of the room from Cleanaway Waste Management, Vic Bansal. There's the important stuff. Get the next slide up. Vic, can you come down and join us at the front of the room here? You're running right to time. So really
I am. Thank you.
That takes you forward, and there's a pointer there.
Thank you. Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to talk about garbage this morning. I know it has been a topical issue, and you've seen that in newspapers. Who would have thought 50 years ago or 40 years ago we were called the old garbos? Nowadays, we are called the sustainability, circular economy, waste management, environmental sciences, and the smartest dude in town. Yeah, so that's how the world has changed. But let me talk about waste first, and let me start with talking about thematics of waste, and then I'm going to talk about Cleanaway and how we fit into all of this picture. So you would have seen in the last 6 months more news about waste, war on waste, circular economy, climate change than you've seen in probably 10, 20 years before. Now, it is not for me to say what side of debate you sit on the climate change. That's your own personal decision. But at the end of the day, where the world is moving now, we can easily see a world of circular economy. We can easily see a world where what we consume and what goes into your waste baskets will come back into economy in some form or shape. And that's where the waste management comes in. So you cannot create a circular economy of future without some kind of a waste management company holding its pay. I think that's an important point. That's where Cleanaway comes up. So the other thing in Australia is you would have seen, for the first time, COAG put waste on the agenda. Never ever happened in the history of this country where waste was on the agenda of the COAG. And within first meeting, all of the ministers and the prime minister made a statement on waste. So what you are seeing in front of you is a fundamental shift in this sector. It's maturing very fast, and that's what I want to have a chat with you about this morning. Let me talk about fundamentally what a waste management company actually does. It is no different than a normal utility, whether it's gas, water, electricity. So for example, you would have millions of customers like we do, small to medium enterprise, large customers, large national customers, all of the municipalities in the country. So a company like Cleanaway would have millions of customers. Most of the customers are contracted. 85% of customers of Cleanaway or any waste management company like us would have a contract. Our contracts are anything from 3 years to 10 years. A municipality which we would be servicing in your area, we would have a 10 to 15 year contract. A small to medium enterprise would be anything from 1 to 3 years. A building like this could be 3 to 5 years. So 85% of the customers of a waste management company generally are contracted. So what you have an opportunity of a recurring revenue. So today, we can sit here and we can probably forecast to some level of accuracy our revenue for the next couple of years. Subsequently, if you can manage your cost right, you can forecast your earnings to some level. The other good part in waste management is what we call operating leverage. What that means is if you can increase your top line by 2, 3, 4%, your bottom line should go from 1 to 3, so 8 to 9%. And how it works is, for argument's sake, if a truck is running up and down on George Street, and you pick up 40 customers, the 41, the 42, the 43, and 44 is actually free, in a sense that your fixed cost is done. Your truck is there, your driver is there. That's called operating leverage. And that's why you would see, and I'll show you some of the results of Cleanaway, operating leverage is a big deal in a waste management company. It is a GDP stock. It is fundamentally a GDP stock, but what comes out of that is an operating leverage and a fantastic cash flow. Because waste is generated by human beings, and that's GDP related, right? There are about 140 municipal councils in Australia, and Cleanaway has about 95 of those, which are about 10 to 15 year contracts. Right. Just to start with the company. So Cleanaway is about 100 years old company. It was started by, it was used to be part of the Brambles Group, started by a young lad in Newcastle about 100 years ago. And subsequently, it has gone through multiple permutations and combinations, now being an independent listed company. So just to give you some scale, about 6,000 employee, 4,500 vehicles, almost 5,000 now, 140,000 CNI, commercial industrial customer, 95 plus municipal councils. We recycle about 14,500 tons of steel, 730 kgs of sharp smart, which I'll come to that in a minute, medical waste, 140 million liters of hydrocarbon oil. We are one of the largest refiner of oil in the country. Go figure. As a waste management company, we refine more oil than big refineries. So all the waste oil from auto workshops gets refined into fuel oil and base oil. Every single doctor or medical surgery you will go to, the yellow bin and the purple bin you go, hopefully you never have to go to an operating theater, but if you're conscious and you see that purple bin, chances are Cleanaway is picking that up. So we are the largest in municipal, largest in commercial industrial, largest in medical, largest in hazard, largest in non-hazardous, and liquid waste. Fine? We are top 20 in the world. Now, you might wonder why this slide. What's a big deal? You're top 20 in the world. Waste management companies all around the world are consolidating. The largest company in the world is now a $20 billion US dollar company. This sector has fundamentally moved since you probably saw it last time. Cleanaway is the largest in the country and largest in the Asia Pacific. But you can see the waste management world is dominated by the Americans and the Europeans. Why Europeans? Because generally Europeans are much ahead in waste management and circular economy than the rest of the world. And the US obviously has scale. So just to give you a sense of where Cleanaway fits in. This is our last year's numbers. They're all green, which is good. But more importantly is our last 5 years history. We've grown our net CAGR revenue grown by 13%, EBITDA by 19%, and that's the operating leverage come through. EBIT by 25.4%, NPAT by 27%, EPS by 25.3%. And what is more comforting is the cash at the back of it. Cash has grown by 18.8%, free cash by 81.8%. We manage our cash capital very well. Return on invested capital is up, and DPS is up by 24%. Now, let me explain to you what a typical waste management company does. So this is what we call the value chain. The front end is the collections. What you see on the road is the front lift, the rear lift, the skip trucks running around with the big brand on the side of it. That's called the collections piece. That is just the start of the game. When you pick up that waste, that has to go somewhere. Those days of 20, 30 years ago when you would lift and dump, as they used to call it, find a hole and put the waste in, it has actually gone. Every single ton you pick it up, you have to process it in a regulated manner. What then you do is we pick up that waste, and that's, I'm talking about millions of tons every week, goes into a resource recovery center where that waste gets converted into some kind of a recycled material, paper, plastic, cardboard, glass, all that stuff, and rest can get treated into landfills or refineries, et cetera. What you're hearing recently is the middle portion where the world is changing. What used to happen till a couple of years ago, that all the developed countries would pick up the waste, or as you call a yellow bin in Sydney, the commingled recycling waste, would get that picked up, would do some kind of resource recovery in developed countries, which included Australia, UK, or America, and then it would go to China. And that's where the kids would sit there in developing countries and go through the waste of the developed nation and then convert into some kind of a material which can go into recycled material. Now, I don't know about you, but there is something in my value, something wrong about kids of one nation looking at the waste of other nation. And that's what China did. China and the Southeast Asian countries said last year, we are happy to take the recycled material from the developed countries. What we are not prepared to take is the waste. What we are looking for to do is you, US or America or Canada or Europe, give me your recycled material. So what that means is do a resource recovery properly and then give me a resource recovered material so that I can put into my manufacturing business. See, what has also happened in the developed countries, manufacturing has gone to zero practically. We have shipped down our manufacturing jobs to the low-cost country sourcing. So guess what? That's where the material is going to get used. We are now looking at a global commodity of recycled products. It's like iron ore, plastic palletization, whatever you call it, the recycled waste is now a global commodity. Better we resource recover, better we can ship it all over the world. The rest can go into treatment and landfill. So that's a typical value chain. The front part of the business in Australia is always going to be low barrier to entry. Theoretically, any one of you can start run a truck and start collecting waste. What you can't do, though, you can't resource recover or put in a landfill or refinery. That back end of that business, you need an EPA permit, and we call them prized infrastructure assets. The company Cleanaway today, market cap is $4.5 billion. You cannot create a new Cleanaway even with $20 billion. The 120 prized infrastructure we have doing resource recovery, treatment, and disposal, you cannot create them from ground up because some of the licenses which Cleanaway has, you will not get it now because they were given in a period of time. The refineries you can't create from scratch because you need an EPA permit. See, in waste, there's a concept called NIMBY, not in my backyard, right? Each one of us create a waste, but nobody wants a waste facility in their backyard. In fact, you would not want to see a Cleanaway transfer station in your neighborhood. You'll be the first one with the placard, right? So the fact that we have 120 of those assets surrounded all over the country gives us a significant competitive advantage. And that is what will secure the future of Cleanaway. Right? So that's kind of a typical how value chain works. We have a concept of evolving ton. Every ton you pick up, you make money while you collect. Then you make money when you recycle or resource recover. And you make money when you take to treatment and disposal. These businesses are normally making 20, 23, 24, 25% EBITDA, right? Generating about 90-plus operating cash flow conversion. For the last couple of years, what we have been doing actively in a company is basically replacing our what we call unlicensed sites, or as I call it, depreciating assets into appreciating assets. We have worked pretty hard over the last 4.5 years to build a very significant portfolio of prized infrastructure assets. And I'm absolutely confident and proud to say that Cleanaway would now today have one of the best prized infrastructure assets for waste management in this country by far. And I would absolutely also confident to say that it will be the second and third party will be significantly behind us. We have 250 locations all over the country, 6,000 employees, and 120 prized infrastructure assets spread across right from Karratha, Darwin, Cairns, Townsville, Rockhampton, Brisbane, Melbourne, Sydney, you name it. Okay? Because we are servicing municipal clients and commercial clients all over the country. So our mission statement is making a sustainable future possible. And I know these are 5-6 words, and every company has a mission. And I call ourselves a pragmatic greenies. We are a commercial greenies, if I can call it that way. It is about actually the waste agenda can only move forward if it is done pragmatically. And when we say making a sustainable future possible, we are saying there is a way, an absolute method today to treat waste properly in such a way that it can go into a circular economy, which can then does not create issues for future generations. I think that's what we believe in. And we are trying to do it very profitably and successfully. So I'll open up for questions.
Thank you, Vic.
Of course.
looking at your slides there. There's one up there, Gemma, just into the gentleman there. Thank you.
Vic, you said there is difficulty for other new entrants to come into the market. Where did Bingo come into the market from?
I beg your pardon, the second part, you said?
What about Bingo?
Oh, Bingo, sorry, okay. Sorry, Bingo, yeah, okay. Well, listen, I think what you have to think through is Bingo is a construction and demolition player, not into CNI and Muni. Yeah, it's a different business, totally different business model. And I've said that in public forum at least 100 times, because while on the auspices of, we can call it a waste management company, it is actually a C&D value chain business. So what they have done, good job, and I give them credit, they are focused purely on C&D market and then taken the benefit out of that. Now, in our case, we stay away from C&D market for simple reasons. Operationally, those skills are non-transferable. So in our case, as I was talking about route density, what happens in a C&D waste business, it's a skip business. So when you renovate a house, a skip comes in, you call the truck driver comes and picks up the skip, and that goes to hub and spoke. So that's a hub and spoke operational model. So I want you to be very clear on the fact that while it's under the, a property developer is a property developer is a property developer, same company, waste management is a waste management. Two different business models, two different companies. And they are only in New South Wales and Victoria, by the way, just to add.
Okay, another one, perhaps on this side. I can get a bit of exercise. I'm coming up to you. Get my steps up for the day.
This company, you just have taken over the company that was in liquidation in Victoria, I think.
Yes, it is.
Why did it go into liquidation? What was wrong? And how do you think you can make it better?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question. Thank you. So what the gentleman is referring to is a private enterprise called SKM in Victoria. It went into receivership, and the reason it went to receivership was that China National Sword was existing. So what used to happen around the globe, by the way, they were a tier two place around the world who would take the waste, in our case, a yellow bin or a blue bin, recycle it to a certain level, and then send it to China. The model, the way the model should work is that the customer needs to pay for lifting the bin, and then the processing, and then going to the China, wherever they want it to go. Their model, unfortunately, was at the time when China was taking all the materials that you could produce. So their model was go to the council saying, don't you worry about paying me for lifting your yellow bin, Mr. Councillor. I will actually pay you $20 per ton because I'll make a money by sending material to China. Well, guess what? That world fundamentally changed. That business model is fundamentally changed in front of our eyes. China says, that's the end of it. So if you're living in a business model paradigm, it closed. And they are not the only one, by the way. Globally, we are finding those tier two players are folding up because there was no motivation for them to invest into technology because there's a buyer on the other end. Now, we believe, because we have invested so much in resource recovery, they have very good assets. And our view is, what we have said to the Victorian government, that we'll buy the debt. So let me be very clear. We have not bought the company as yet. We have bought the debt from the Commonwealth Bank. We have put them in a receivership. And now we are working through the system. Now, we would be one of the buyers when that comes to the table, but our aim would be modernize those resource recovery centers and use the proper material in a global supply chain, but use that properly as a good waste management player should be doing. And you will see most of that. The number two players around the world are under a lot of pressure because the business model has shifted. And that this whole China thing, while it's getting a lot of news, is actually good for the global well-established players because you can use this change in model for your advantage if you are fast at acting on it. So that's what has happened.
Okay, we're right on time again. Why don't you join me in thanking Vic for insight to more than garbage, I'd suggest. Leave that, we need that one. Thank you. All right, on to the next presenter. Just move the slides forward. Here we are. Elmo, as I mentioned, Elmo's standing in at very short notice, and we're very grateful to Danny for coming to help us to fill that gap at very short notice, as I said the other day. So without further ado, let's hear from Danny Lessem and find out a little bit more about Elmo Software. Welcome, Danny.
Forward and a bit of a point of view.
Okay, thanks. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Today, I'm going to give you a bit of an overview on Elmo. I'm assuming not everyone's heard of Elmo, so we'll go over the business, where we are today, where we come from. I'll also have a look at our financial results for FY19 and give you a bit of an idea of our direction into FY20. So starting off with a company overview, we're a provider of an integrated cloud platform covering human resources, payroll, and rostering and time and attendance. So the point of difference between our offering in the marketplace and others is the actual breadth of the solution. It's a frictionless convergence solution which enables companies in the region to manage and automate process and pay of their people. So really, really important is we're still very early in that automation process around HR functionality, and Elmo is in a very good position to automate businesses in the region. So where we are today, we've got 277 employees, we've got 6 offices, and we have over 1,300 customers. An important aspect of our solution is that it is 100% cloud-based. So it hasn't got any legacy technology. It's got no history of on-premises delivery. It's all completely scalable because it's delivered across the internet. It has a single code base, which means that we can evolve the solution quicker than our competitors as well. And we also have a very large addressable market in value of $2.4 billion. So just looking at our history, where we came from. So we started off, we're not a startup, we're what's referred to as a scale-up, a very fast-growing company. I co-founded the company back in 2002, so it's been a 17-year journey. And where we started off in just one point of that employee life cycle. We started off with a solution to manage and automate learning and development in organizations. And then as a result of feedback from our client base, and we've always been led by the market, we've always listened to our customers, basic feedback was they wanted to see a broader convergence solution, not just to automate and manage one aspect of that employee life cycle, but something that could manage and automate the entire employee journey. So around about 2014, we put together a product development roadmap, and then we started to add additional modules to our platform. The key was to make them frictionless and interoperable. So it was appeared to be one solution from the user, one dashboard, one employee experience. And we can see here that from the time of listing at IPO, we've grown from 7 to 13 modules, and we've spanned across the talent management modules now into payroll and rostering and time and attendance. So it's a very, very broad module. And what it's enabled us to do is attract a lot of organizations that want to have a single solution, a single dashboard that they can use on any device for their employees to manage their sick leave, to do their performance reviews, to do their payroll, et cetera. And just in terms of it, to without any friction between those systems, without integration problems. So just to give you an example here is we can see the modules we added in 2017, HR Core, and then in 18 we added payroll, rewards and recognition, remuneration, and then in 19, rostering and time and attendance. So we've really grown that module. And as we have, we've got additional investment from our existing customers, and also attracted a lot of new customers. So just having a look at the size of our addressable market. Now, we are focused on Australia and New Zealand, and the reason that we focus on this region is because it's a very large addressable market. There are approximately just under 24,000 organizations, and currently we've only got a 5.6% penetration. So we only touch 5.6% of the organizations in our region, and we have a penetration of, on average, 2.4 modules out of a potential 13. So this means we've got a lot of headroom to get new customers onto our platform. As I said earlier, they're very early in the engagement of technology, and we have a lot of brand equity here. And on the other side, with our over 1,300 clients, we have a big opportunity to sell them additional modules. Now, very importantly, we can see our growth base there, compounded annual growth since 2000, and 15 of 51.6%. That's in customer numbers. Very importantly is our revenue model. So it's all subscription-based. They're long-term contracts. So what it means is when we get a client on is they continue to pay us annual license fees or annual subscription fees, and they pay them annually in advance. So it means that we've got a pyramiding business model. And I'll go through the financials in a moment. If you put together that very, very stable revenue model and you put together high growth, then you can see it unlocks huge opportunity. If we look at the breakdown of the addressable market, as I said, the whole hypothesis here is that there's an appetite for a wider convergence solution. And here we've broken it down into in terms of dollar value, in terms of the size of the market for talent management, HR core, payroll, and rostering and time and attendance. And if we see we put them all together, it's a $2.4 billion opportunity. Now, just to put that in perspective, if we look at our revenue guidance for FY20, it's between $53 and $55 million, but the addressable market is $2.4 billion in scale size. So there's heaps of headroom for growth. Moving on to some of the financials, and I'll go through some of our key metrics here. I won't bore you with the detail, but starting off with our annualized recurrent revenue, that is what we build in subscription revenues or what we took to our P&L in June of 19, and we times it by 12, and this gives us that base revenue for FY20. It came in at $46 million, which is an increase of 47.8% from the prior period. So again, the idea here is high growth, and this is long-term revenue, which we'll keep on billing year on year. If we look at it in terms of the revenue numbers, our FY19 pro forma revenue came in at $42.6 million, and our statutory revenue at $40.1 million, which is up 51.2% on FY18. Very importantly, our GP margin is very high. It's at 86.6%. And this is really important because at scale, with a high GP margin, we'll be able to obviously get a lot of profitability out of the business. Looking at our customer numbers, as I mentioned, just over 1,300, and that's up 30.1% on the prior period. Another important metric is our customer retention rate, which came in at 92.1%. And if we look at it in dollar value, it's 110.8% that's baking in churn. So the 110.8% shows the value of the cross-sell of those additional modules. And then the final metric, which is the lifetime value of the customer base, as of 30 June 19, came in at 621 million. And that's up 156 million from 30 June 18. And that's calculated on an annual recurrent revenue basis. So really important is how we work out the lifetime value is we look at that subscription or that average subscription per the client, and we factor in the churn statistic and the GP margin. And that's why it's a very big opportunity. If we look at annual recurrent revenue, and this is really the key metric, this is what we call a lead metric, is this, if we look at that $46 million, this will be our base revenue going into FY20. So this is our base revenue. If we don't write another dollar in new sales, we'll do $46 million of revenue, less a small amount of churn. So really, really important, it pyramids up as we go. And we can see this growth year on year, or over the last period, is at 47.8%. So that's, we're a high growth company. So we have strong revenue visibility. Now, out of our total revenue, 95.4% of it is subscription. So we've got a very small amount, so 4.6% is the one-time professional services revenue. So not all revenue is equal. Subscription revenue comes in year on year. Turnstile revenue or professional services comes in once off. So we focus on that long-term revenue as we go through. And just to reinforce it, our customers pay annually in advance, and the typical contract length is 3 years in duration. So we've got a lot of contract certainty as we go through. So again, really important, that revenue model is about pyramiding the revenue year on year. We have a lot of foresight. We know what we're going to get in. We know what the base is. And then it's about bringing in new customers. So if we look at our growth strategy, we continue to have a strong organic growth strategy. And we accelerate this with selective acquisitions of complementary technology or sticky client lists. So we are getting new customers in our existing markets, and we also have a sight of a new market segment. So just to give you some more metrics here, we had 265 organic new customers added in FY19. And just in terms of it, what we're seeing with a broader suite of products, we're seeing the new business is taking up 3.7 modules on average. So the more modules we have, the larger the appetite for those incoming new customers. Very excitingly, we've also seen an increased adoption in what we term the low mid-market. So these are slightly smaller organizations. That's organizations with circa 50 to 200 employees. They're starting to engage technology, and they're looking for that broad, frictionless platform which Elmo rolls out. So that's very exciting as we go. We're also experiencing greater usage from our existing clients. So we can see here, in terms of incremental annual recurrent revenue, it came in at 5.3 million from existing customers. So the larger our client cohort, the more value-add sales we have. So again, another source of revenue. We continue to expand and enhance the product line as well. So we acquired and integrated rostering and time and attendance. And very importantly, we continue to spend on R&D. So 28.8% of our FY19 statutory revenue on a cash basis was spent on R&D. And we'll continue. We committed to the spend. It's really important. The more we're spending on our solution, the better the client experience, the more modules they're buying, and the more clients we're attracting as well. We also have an ongoing acquisition mandate. We're looking at either complementary technology, so where they're adjacencies, we're looking to bring them into our platform, as well as sticky client lists, where we have, say, point solution vendors, where we can bring them in and sell our additional modules to their existing clients. I'll end off with our FY20 outlook. So we have obviously strong momentum going into FY20. As I mentioned before, we've got that $46 million ARR, which is that base revenue, and we have a high degree of subscription revenue, so it's 95.4%. So there's strong momentum. Again, Elmo's not just about growth, growth, growth. It's about sustainable growth, sustainable growth, sustainable growth. We have a large market opportunity, so we have more multi-module sales because of our ever-increasing or broadening suite. And we also have increased traction in a new market segment, slightly smaller organizations. So that really augments our growth potential and our view of the addressable market. The important thing is we will continue to invest going into FY20 in growth. So in sales and marketing is really focusing on acquiring more clients and also facilitating the cross-sell. In research and development, we're looking to expedite the evolution of the product suite. And in client services, we're looking to accelerate the onboarding or the configuration of client solutions so they'll experience a quicker, more accurate implementation, and they'll be available to purchase more modules quicker. So ending off with some numbers on our FY20 guidance. Annual recurrent revenue between 61 and 63 million. Revenue between 53 and 55 million. And EBITDA between -1 and -3 million. And I've got 20 seconds left, so we're ready for questions.
You've actually got a little bit more than 20 seconds because we said that was 15 minutes talking time. We've got a couple of minutes for questions. The gentleman over here, if I could just ask you to pass that through and then back to me.
Thanks very much. My question is in two parts, and so I apologise in advance if the answer's already been given and I missed it. Irrespective of the modules that your customers take up, could you give me a thumbnail, in percentage terms if you like, of what industry sectors your customers are from, both in your 1,300 turnover customers that continue on with contracts, and also in your one-off customer, your turnstile customers, your one-off customers?
Yeah, so just in terms of the customer spread, we go across all sectors. So we have a very large view of that $2.4 billion opportunity of those roughly 24,000 organisations in Australia and New Zealand. We don't have any undue concentration in any one vertical or one sector or size of organisation. So we go right across government, all three tiers of government, not-for-profit, and all the other verticals. And sorry, the second part of your question? In percentage, we just in terms of it per sector, we don't divulge the percentages in each sector. But needless to say, there's very little concentration.
With respect, that's confidential. You don't want to surprise it. The other question was of the turnstile customers, what sector do they come from?
If you could just repeat that, Danny, so the rest of the audience could hear the remainder.
Yeah, turnstile customers. We don't. We. No, I'll point that out. Is we said that we've got roughly 96% of revenue is recurrent in nature.
Yes.
Just about 4% is professional services. The professional services will go to the long-term customers. There'll be once-off integrations, items like that.
Nice. Thank you.
Another one here. Yes, more steps for me. This is good. I'll come to the gentleman behind you.
Just in reference to the structure of the organisation, where do most of your coders actually reside? Are they based here in Australia or overseas?
Yeah, so our coders reside in Australia and New Zealand. The majority are in Australia.
Another one here.
I was interested in your dividend policy. Do you have a dividend policy?
we're a growth company very early into the growth opportunity, so... we're investing in that growth, so the chance of getting dividend at this stage is very low. So I think that talks to our dividend policy. We do believe that investing in growth, in long-term sustainable growth, will deliver the best shareholder return.
And one more last one, perhaps on Gemma's side, so I don't get too fit. No, I have to get fit. There's one at the back of the room. I'm sure this is a setup.
You operate in the regulated market or unregulated. If you can't tell us the difference, tell us the percentage. Whether you operate on a regulated market or unregulated, and if you could tell us the difference between the two percentage.
Yeah, so there is a lot of compliance drivers in terms of the client uptake, but it is not a regulated market per se. So just in terms of compliance, there's compliance around obviously payroll, and there's integrations. We have integrations with the Australian Taxation Office and the New Zealand equivalent. But per se, it's not a regulated environment across the platform.
Okay, we're going to leave it there, Danny, but please join me in thanking Danny and Elmo Software for standing in at very short notice to help us out and broadening the discussion base we've been having this morning. Someone's doing that for me, that's even better. The guys at ASX were very quick and swift to respond to, so whilst there wasn't an outline of Elmo in the printed copy of the brochure you would have received, there's this insert for both it and for metrics, so you're all up to date. Our next presenter is from Lendlease, Steve McCann. Is Steve
I got around? A question about our dividend
Steve,
policy.
If you'd like to make your way down here, we'll get started. That'll take you forward. There's a pointer if you need it.
Great.
And there's a water bottle there on there.
Okay, thanks very much. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for the opportunity for me to speak to you today. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we're on the land
of the Gadigal people, and I extend my respects to their elders, past, present, and future. I'll start off talking a little bit about our approach, and then I'll get into a discussion around our full year results for FY19. Lendlease is an international property and infrastructure group. Our core expertise is in shaping cities and creating strong and connected communities. We create award-winning urban precincts. We create communities, retail precincts, work environments. We try to create everything to the highest sustainability standards. We also create essential civic and social infrastructure, including state-of-the-art hospitals, universities, and stadiums around the world. Urbanisation is the key trend that drives our strategy. Gateway cities around the world everywhere are facing significant challenges in absorbing the increased density that comes with urbanisation. And they're increasingly going to require carefully master-planned mixed-use precincts where we can apply the breadth of our skill set. In combination, our business model, our strong track record, and our financial strength provides a point of difference that we think very few people can compete with. In our view, that competitive advantage is generated by our integrated model, and that's demonstrated in a number of different ways. We have the ability to originate, to fund, to deliver, and to manage property and infrastructure assets. We have significant access to third-party capital to fund our developments and to improve returns. And we focus on execution excellence. We now have a demonstrated track record of delivering strong precincts in core gateway cities. And we attract the best people to the best projects as a result. We have five focus areas through which we aim to create long-term value, and they underpin our strategy and our ability to create safe and sustainable outcomes. Our most important priority is health and safety. Our commitment to the health and safety of everyone who interacts with a Lendlease place holds the highest priority in our organisation. We have a comprehensive framework of safety. It includes global minimum requirements that we apply everywhere we operate. And these have helped us to significantly improve our safety record, but we still have a long way to go to eliminate incidents everywhere that we work. Environmental and social sustainability are also key focus areas of our business. And this has been a key aspect of Lendlease's culture for many years. And pleasingly, our APPF Commercial Property Fund has been ranked the most sustainable fund in the world in the Global Real Estate Sustainability Benchmark Awards for 4 out of the last 5 years. And our portfolio management framework is the core of our financial strategy. We focus on return on equity, and we focus on earnings per security to measure those returns, and our target is a return on equity of 10 to 14%. Excuse me, this slide provides a snapshot of our footprint across our three operating segments of development, construction, and investments that I just referred to. And while we operate across four geographic regions, we're very much targeted on cities and on gateway cities. We employ this strategy typically where places, where cities are experiencing higher population growth, where they have the most appealing employment prospects, and where they attract the most institutional capital. They're also the most resilient cities through property and economic cycles. We now have 21 major urbanisation projects located in 10 gateway cities around the world, and our development pipeline is now approaching $100 billion. The construction backlog for our core construction business is about $15.6 billion, and that business provides design and delivery support for our integrated model. The investment segment has $3.7 billion of investments, $35 billion of funds under management, and $28.7 billion of assets that we manage for third parties. Just turning to our FY19 result, which we delivered last week. It was a difficult year for the group. We took a significant provision in the first half in relation to underperforming projects in our engineering business, and they impacted the overall result. Profit after tax was $467 million, with earnings per stapled security of 82.4 cents. and distributions of 42 cents per stapled security represented a payout ratio at the midpoint of our 40 to 60% target range. The group's core business, excluding engineering and services, had a solid year with profit after tax of $804 million and a return on equity of 12.8% towards the upper end of our 10 to 14% range. Origination was very strong, with the group's development pipeline securing four major urbanisation projects, one of which we secured post-balance date. And development return on invested capital of 11.6% was underpinned by strong apartment earnings across a range of our urbanisation projects, the completion of the office precinct at Paya Lebar Quarter in Singapore, and the formation of the Residential Investment Partnership in the United States. The core construction margin of 2.2% was generated on $9.7 billion of revenue. Our investments, return on investment capital of 10.8%, reflected strong growth in funds under management and solid ownership income. We announced at the half year full 2019 result the decision that the engineering and services business is non-core and will be separated from the group. A comprehensive strategic review concluded that this decision is in the best interests of our employees and security holders and will allow both the Lendlease Group and the engineering and services businesses to focus on their core competitive advantage. So as part of that separation, a sale process is underway. It's been initiated for the engineering and services business. It's generated a good level of interest and several parties are currently undertaking detailed due diligence. We remain committed to delivering the best possible outcome for the sale process for our clients, our employees, and our security holders. At the half-year result, we announced a preliminary estimate of future restructuring costs associated with that separation of $450 million to $550 million pre-tax. And the restructuring cost estimate remains appropriate based on the current portfolio and the progress we're making on the sale. So in terms of performance for FY19, the EBITDA loss of $461 million for the non-core business included a $500 million provision for underperforming projects that was brought to account in the first half of the financial year. And that provision related primarily to three engineering projects with the estimated cost of completing those projects incorporated within the provision. We've reviewed the status of the entire engineering portfolio as part of our full year reporting process, and our reviews confirm that the level of provisioning is appropriate. The group remains in a very strong financial position with gearing at the bottom of the target range and $3.9 billion of available liquidity. During the year, we cemented the group's position as a global leader in urbanisation. Securing four projects takes our development pipeline to almost $100 billion. Providing substantial visibility of expected future earnings. And we were delighted to be chosen by Google to partner with them to develop three mixed-use communities in the San Francisco Bay Area. This predominantly residential-led scheme has an end value of approximately $20 billion and will deliver more than 15,000 new homes over a 10 to 15-year timeframe. In FY19, three other major urbanisation projects were secured. The Milan Innovation District, which is the site of the World Expo 2015, is a mixed-use development with an estimated end value of $3.6 billion. Lakeshore East in Chicago is a $2.1 billion residential-led project, and Victoria Cross here in Sydney is an integrated station development anchored by an office tower with an estimated end value of $1.1 billion. Each of these projects are held through capital efficient arrangements that provide us flexibility around delivery and timing. In addition, we're the preferred partner on two projects valued at $17 billion in the UK, Thamesmead Waterfront and Birmingham Smithfield. During the year, we also progressed several capital partner initiatives in the residential sector. We launched a partnership with First State Super, which has acquired buildings in Chicago and Boston, and more recently committed to the first phase residential at our newly secured Lakeshore East project in Chicago. In Sydney, demand for our high quality office project was strong. We rebalanced our holdings in our office precinct at Barangaroo and we introduced two new capital partners to the precinct. And we've reached a resolution with Infrastructure New South Wales on the Barangaroo sightlines issue, with views from our premium apartments now retained across central Barangaroo from the Harbour Bridge to the Sydney Opera House. This is a very good outcome for Lendlease, and shortly we will announce the launch of our first residential tower at 1 Sydney Harbour. We have a development joint venture with the Abu Dhabi Investment Authority in Singapore, which saw the completion of the 83,000 square metre office precinct at Paya Lebar Quarter. And its completion takes funds under management from the office towers to more than $2 billion. And we also launched a partnership in Asia to invest $1 billion US dollars in the data centre sector across the Asia Pacific. These partnerships that we continue to establish highlight the strength and attractiveness in our view of our business model, which enables us to secure high quality projects and then deliver and manage those projects for our clients. Being chosen as the development partner for transformational projects across target gateway cities by both public and private sector clients is a strong endorsement of our urbanisation capabilities, which are increasingly being recognised as world leading. 5 years ago, we had an urbanisation pipeline of $25 billion, comprising seven major projects. At $81.2 billion, it is now more than three times that size, with 21 major projects. In recent years, our development activity has averaged about $4 billion per annum, and there is scope for that to accelerate materially over the medium term, given the significant growth of the pipeline and its diversity by gateway city and by product type. So we're currently looking at the pace of production that we're likely to accelerate, and we'll come out to the market and inform of a new higher annual rate. And as we've highlighted previously, there is an abundance of capital pursuing these opportunities, so we don't think that capital partner demand nor availability of product are constraints. To that end, we've got to focus on our own execution capability, and we're planning for the next phase of investment for growth. A substantial uplift in the amount of the institutional grade investment product will be created for our capital partners, and therefore the group's investment platform will grow accordingly. We expect to create about $50 billion of investment grade product for institutions from our current secured pipeline. That's about $29 billion of commercial assets and about $20 billion of build to rent product across 17,000 homes. So since 2014, our funds under management has more than doubled from $16 billion to $35 billion, and the group's well placed to double that amount again as we work through our pipeline. Excuse me. The dying throes of a cold. So on to our outlook. We believe that we're strongly positioned for long-term growth. Our development pipeline, as I've said earlier, is approaching $100 billion and it's never been stronger. Our origination and placemaking capabilities are unrivaled, and our success in securing international projects has taken our global portfolio to 21 major projects across 10 gateway cities. We believe our success internationally is testament to our strategy and the depth of talent that we've been able to build over many years. So I'd like to thank our team for their outstanding efforts in securing these projects, and we look forward to building them out for our clients. Our construction backlog is also healthy, with $15.6 billion in our backlog, diversified by client, sector and geography. And our demonstrated ability to partner with third-party capital continues to underpin our business model. As I've indicated, the funds management trajectory for future growth is well beyond the current $35 billion. We expect it to more than double in size as we execute our pipeline. We have, as I said, commenced the separation of our non-core business with a sale process underway. And as we work through that separation, we remain committed to delivering the best possible outcome for our clients, employees, and security holders. I'd like to conclude by reiterating that our business model and our approach is unique. It provides what we believe is a sustainable competitive advantage. And the experience of the last year has highlighted our need to stay focused on our core business in delivering our strategy. So with that, I'm happy to take questions.
All right, we might just let you get your voice back and have a glass of water while we do that. A couple of questions. Gemma, there's one right alongside you. That's too easy for me. Yes, you're going this time, definitely.
Steve, thank you for an excellent presentation given under difficult circumstances with your throat. The handout we all got today on the key financials shows that your figures are identical to Mirvac's. I'm just wondering whether you're using their accountant or they're using yours. It says that your revenue is 106.07 million, and I just wondering.
We're putting that down to coincidence.
We'll put that down to coincidence, yeah.
Easy answer to that one. Sir,
although I will proudly say that Sue Lloyd Hurwitz used to be at Lendlease some years back.
Steve, does Lendlease have anything happening in the area of build to rent? And do you see it as a significant area of development in Australia?
Yeah, so overseas, we're very focused on the build to rent market. In our pipeline, so I talked about the development pipeline of $50 billion being institutional grade. So it's an $80 billion urbanisation pipeline. $30 billion of that is the typical build to sell apartments that we do. The other $30 billion of that is commercial buildings, so office buildings, et cetera, and $20 billion is build-to-rent apartments. So there are 17,000 apartments that we'll be doing primarily in the UK and the US that will go into that platform. We established a partnership last year with First State Super, who have committed capital to the US in partnership with us, and in the UK with Canadian Pension Plan, they've committed capital to pursue the build-to-rent market in the UK. So they will become very big parts of our platform. In Australia, we think it's a bit tougher. The tax regime here makes returns from build to rent a bit less attractive. And you need to get to scale. So our view is you need to have at least $1 billion under management before you can create an operating profit from managing those assets. So we're at scale with $20 billion in our backlog in the UK and the US. In Australia, we feel that our best position today is to continue to focus on the build to sell market. But I would say that over the next 10 years or so, affordability of housing and affordability of rental product is going to drive that build to rent market around the world, in our view.
Okay, thank you. They seem to be all on your side, Gemma. That lady and the gentleman a little to your right.
Thank you very much. It's an interesting presentation. Obviously, a bit of a challenging year for you. Any learnings from what you faced in the engineering business that you're looking to move forward in terms of risk management practices for the remainder of your core business in the coming year?
Yeah, so we did a review between November and February in relation to the engineering and services business and where that fit within our overall strategy. It was a pretty comprehensive review. We looked at the risk profile of that business compared to our core business. And the reality is there are very different risks in the heavy civil engineering space versus the development space in real estate and versus the commercial building space as well. So the uncertainties that you deal with in that sector are far greater. And therefore, as you build out those projects, you need to allow sufficient contingency and margin to deal with those uncertainties. When things go wrong, there are not very many levers to manage those challenges. So once you commence an underground tunnel, for example, if productivity isn't where it needs to be, there's very little you can do to improve that. So if the soil conditions are worse than you expected and you're stuck producing at a lower rate, you can't sort of stop, you can't change direction, you're kind of stuck. Whereas when you're building a major development precinct above ground, there are a lot of different things that go to that risk profile, the tenancy risk, the cost, the program, the timing, the sequencing. A lot of those things are within your control. And so our view is the risk profile really doesn't marry up well with the rest of our business, which is why we've made the decision to sell that business. Lessons going forward for our core business. We think that broadly our business has de-risked the cycle in many projects because we're working on land management deals where we invest the capital as we go. We don't spend all the money up front, so we've mitigated that risk to some extent. But clearly execution risk is important. We're investing a lot and have invested a lot in our systems and processes. We are aiming to become much more codified and standardised around the world because as an international company, if you don't bring international capability in a relatively straightforward, repeatable process, then you're not really getting the benefit from scale. So we are very focused on trying to achieve that.
Okay, the last one, Gemma, just on your right, the gentleman in the suit and tie. It needs to be a quick one, sir.
In your view, why is Mirvac a better buy?
Why is it a better buy? I'm not sure that is my view.
Read the disclaimer.
What was the question again, just for clarity?
What are the areas in which Mirvac is better than your company?
We're a very different company to Mirvac. So Mirvac is a domestically focused development business. Our business model is around urbanisation in core gateway cities. So whilst we both participate in the real estate space, we're a very different business. We compete from time to time on some product, but not that often, actually. We compete in really different spaces.
Okay, join me in saying thank you to Steve for a presentation under difficult circumstances. We take...
No problem.
Thank you for that. Okay, I think our next presenter from Telstra, Vicki, is in the room. If I can ask Vicki to... She's waving at me, that's even better. ..to come on down. A good response from Steve there to a direct question about comparing two investments that may seem to be similar. When you start to dig below the surface, and that's one of the purposes of today's sessions, you find out they are a little different, even though in some areas there may be some corresponding strategies, but a good insight to two property companies, at least today. So it's my pleasure to ask Vicki Brady to join us and talk to us a little bit about Telstra Corporation. Thank you. So, it's disappointed here for me.
Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone. It is my great pleasure to be here this morning and have the opportunity to update you on Telstra's focus and our performance. My name is Vicki Brady. I'm the Chief Financial Officer for Telstra. So I wanted to start firstly with a brief overview of Telstra. So Telstra is Australia's leading telecommunications and technology company. We operate in over 20 countries and territories and offer a full range of communication services. In Australia, we provide around 18 million mobile retail services and 3.7 million fixed bundle and data services. We also have around 1.3 million shareholders, and I suspect many of you in the room today will be shareholders of Telstra. Our most recent financial results for the year ending 30 June 2019 were released to the market on Thursday, the 15th of August. Shortly, I will take you through those results. Before I do, it's important to explain what a significant year it has been for Telstra. FY19 has been a pivotal year for us. Notwithstanding the intense competitive environment and the challenging structural dynamics of our industry, it is a year in which we started to see a turning point in the fortunes of the company from the changes we have embraced. In FY19, we completed the strategic investment program we announced in 2016, investing $2.6 billion to create networks for the future and to digitise our business. As an industry, we passed the halfway mark in the migration of customers to the NBN network. We estimate Telstra has now absorbed around 50%, or $1.7 billion since FY16, of the economic headwind from the NBN. We also commenced our T22 strategy, and I will talk to you about our significant progress shortly. Today, Telstra is a very different company, much simpler, more customer-focused than we were a year ago. Let me take you through the key financial results and achievements in the year. For FY19, our financial results were in line with the guidance we provided to the market. As you can see on the slide, our total income for the year decreased 3.6% to $27.8 billion on a reported basis. EBITDA decreased 21.7% to $8 billion on a reported basis. Underlying EBITDA, which excludes one-off NBN income, restructuring costs and impairments, decreased 11.2% to $7.8 billion. After accounting for the significant restructuring costs of approximately $800 million and asset impairments of approximately $500 million, our net profit after tax decreased 39.6% to $2.1 billion. These results clearly show Telstra's circumstances today. They are very different from what they were before the NBN. We are no longer the national wholesale provider. That part of our business, the revenue and value, is progressively being transferred back to the government via the NBN. But Telstra is reaching an inflection. The estimated NBN economic headwind that we absorbed in FY19 was approximately $600 million. If you exclude this headwind, you see a clearer picture of what our business looks like without the impact of NBN. In FY19, our underlying EBITDA declined by around 4%, or $400 million. This current financial year, FY20, we expect to be the peak headwind year. We estimate that the impact in FY20 will be between $800 million and $1 billion. However, underlying EBITDA, excluding the in-year NBN headwinds, the clearest view of our financial performance of our business, is expected to deliver up to $500 million of growth in FY20. Further detail regarding our FY20 guidance, along with the assumptions and conditions upon which we have provided them, are available in the materials we lodged with the ASX on August 15. I'd like to take you through the progress we're making on our T22 strategy. In June of last year, we recognised we needed to do more to accelerate our change and lift our aspiration. This is why we launched T22, a strategy to simplify the business, reduce the cost base for the future, and maximise the value of our infrastructure assets. As you can see, the strategy is built around four pillars with two critical enablers. We have made a very strong start on each of the pillars of T22. We have reduced more than 1,800 consumer and small business plans to just 20, creating simpler, more flexible ways for customers to choose the best value connectivity devices and services for them. We launched the next generation of our smart modem to help keep people connected at home. The smart modem includes a 4G chipset, which enables voice as well as data backup. Already, 1.3 million customers are using it. We saw a 22% reduction in the volume of service calls to our call centres from our consumer and small business customers. Our digital experiences now account for more than 53% of service transactions, with online sales interactions for consumer and small business customers, we have grown to 16.8%. The message is clear. Our customers increasingly prefer to use digital channels to interact with us. This creates great opportunities for us to deliver better experiences more efficiently. As well as flexibility, simplicity, and choice, our customers told us they also wanted to be rewarded and recognised for their loyalty. During the year, we introduced Telstra Plus, a program offering customers the opportunity to earn rewards, discounts, and new technology, as well as bonus entertainment and more. Already, more than 770,000 customers have enrolled in Telstra Plus. As part of T22, we are also simplifying the structure and the ways of working within our business to empower our people to deliver better service to our customers. The organisational changes have meant we have now announced reductions of around 6,000 in our direct workforce. This represents 75% of the net 8,000 direct workforce role reductions we estimated would be necessary when we launched T22. While difficult, these changes are about adapting the business to a rapidly changing market and the transfer of a substantial part of our business to NBN. We've also accelerated our cost reduction program, and we remain on track to reach our target of reducing annual underlying fixed costs by $2.5 billion by FY22. We have already achieved $1.17 billion in reductions since FY16, and we are targeting a further reduction in fixed costs this year of $660 million. At the same time, we are actively managing our portfolio with an aim of monetising up to $2 billion of assets to further strengthen our balance sheet. Earlier this month, we established an unlisted property trust to own 37 of our high-value and strategically important exchange properties. We then reached an agreement to sell a 49% stake in this property trust, realising $700 million of value. Combined with other transactions, this shows the continued progress we are making, and the completion of these transactions will bring the total value of assets monetised as part of T22 to around $1 billion. Let me now turn to 5G. One of the most exciting aspects of Telstra is our global leadership in 5G, the next generation of mobile technology. Telstra was the first to introduce 5G here in Australia. Our customers enjoyed the first 5G handsets available in the world through a number of exclusive arrangements with major manufacturers. Our rollout of 5G coverage is ongoing and is currently focused on CBD locations and selected regional centres, where more than 4 million people live, work and visit every day. We have already rolled out 5G-enabled mobile base stations in 10 cities nationally. Over the next 12 months, we expect the area our 5G network covers to increase almost fivefold and to reach into at least 35 Australian cities. For the tens of thousands of customers already using our 5G network, they are experiencing twice the speed of 4G, with almost half of their data usage coming over the 5G network. And we are only at the very beginning. 5G will deliver ultra-fast speeds, ultra-low latency, and greater bandwidth. This will enable applications and technologies including the Internet of Things, cloud computing, big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. All areas where Telstra continues to build expertise and capabilities. Just like we saw with 4G, we believe as 5G rolls out, customers will be willing to pay more to access this new technology and the great benefits it brings. 5G will also enable new revenue streams that do not exist today, and as well, will deliver capital efficiency by reducing the cost per bit of data travelling over the network. As this amazing technology requires a major investment of capital, so I wanted to talk to you about our capital position. Telstra continues to enjoy one of Australia's strongest and most stable balance sheets. Our A-band credit rating from Standard & Poor's and Moody's rating agencies is a vote of confidence in our business. This strong rating also enables us to borrow money at very competitive rates. Telstra's debt levels, average maturities, and gross borrowing costs were all relatively flat year on year. We remain within our comfort ranges for all of our credit metrics. As many of you will recall, in 2017, we reviewed and updated our capital management framework. This included asking shareholders what they believed our highest priorities should be. As a result, our framework is now designed to maximise long-term value for shareholders, maintain our financial strength, and retain our financial flexibility. The definition of underlying earnings in our capital management framework has now been updated to explicitly exclude restructuring costs, impairments, and other guidance adjustments, as well as one-off NBN receipts. Within this framework in mind, for FY19, the board resolved to pay a dividend, a final dividend of 8 cents per share fully franked, including an ordinary dividend of 5 cents per share and a special dividend of 3 cents per share. Total dividends for FY19 are 16 cents per share fully franked, including 10 cents ordinary and 6 cents of special dividends. Let me summarise. FY19 was a year in which we met the financial guidance we provided to the market and built strong momentum behind our T22 strategy. Our progress was the result of our dedicated employees who are focused on serving our customers and helping us return value to our shareholders. As expected, and as previously flagged, our results also reflect current market realities, including the impact of the NBN and intense competition. While these factors will continue to influence the year ahead, we are now approximately halfway through the negative headwind from the NBN, and we expect the hard work of our teams to translate into momentum in our underlying business. Excluding the in-year NBN headwind, we expect underlying EBITDA to grow by up to $500 million in FY20. We are also sitting at an incredibly exciting inflection point in technology, in telecommunications, and for Telstra. We are at the dawn of 5G, and we have entered a period of rapid technology innovation, which will provide significant opportunities for Telstra in the future. T22 is about positioning us in this world, which will be a simpler, more digitally enabled business with the best network, a strong balance sheet, and the capabilities, culture, and ways of working we need to succeed. I encourage you to review our complete suite of FY19 materials available on our investor website, www.telstra.com/investor. Finally, if you are a shareholder and you'd like to hear more from Telstra, please ensure you provide your current email address to our share registry via Link Services. Thank you again for the opportunity to update you today, and I look forward to taking some questions.
Thank you, Vicki. Join me in thanking Vicki, because I have a feeling we've got a couple of questions probably from the audience.
Excellent.
Gemma, have you got a question over your side? No? Mm-hmm. Something on that gentleman at the front here. Here I go again.
Yeah, thanks for that presentation. The NBN is obviously causing some dramas with the technology side for Telstra. Do you see the 5G having an impact to, say, replace the NBN?
It's a great question. It's actually one we've been asked again a lot through this period of results presentation. So I would just step back and talk to a few aspects that I think are important. Firstly, Telstra has been very vocal externally around the wholesale pricing for NBN. We do believe for the industry to be vibrant, for us to have the right economics as an industry, as retail service providers, to invest, that wholesale price that NBN charges does need to reduce. And I context that because it's very important. As 5G technology rolls out, there is no doubt for a portion of customers, and we think a relatively small portion of customers, it's probably the right technology choice. 5G is very good at high speed, but mobile networks don't have the same bandwidth and capacity as a fixed line network does. So if you're a low data user at home, then it may well be that mobile technologies like 5G are a good solution. But we still believe for the broad number of households across Australia, who are enjoying streaming lots of Netflix, streaming lots of content on their big screen TVs at high definition and 4K and all the rest to come, that actually a fixed line connection is very important. And that's why we have been strongly advocating that the wholesale pricing from the NBN does need to change to ensure, as retail service providers, we can all provide the best possible experience for customers in the home.
I think you've already addressed one part of the question in terms of the fixed lines. So it's here to stay and it's here to keep going. Can you comment about the competition in the place with the other providers, Vodafone and the likes?
Mm-hmm. Mm. Another great question. It is undoubtedly in the telco market here in Australia, it is an incredibly competitive dynamic. And as many of you would know, there is a decision pending on whether Vodafone and TPG merge together, which I'm guessing might be where the question's coming from. Look, our view is we respect and do not underestimate any of our competitors in the Australian marketplace. We've clearly set our strategy under T22, and we're very confident in that strategy and are pleased with how we've executed in the first year. So, of course, we keep an eye on the competitive market, but we are very, very focused on executing our strategy to deliver our customers the best possible experiences. We're also confident no matter which way it lands, whether Vodafone and TPG end up merged or they remain as separate entities, we're confident we've got a great strategy in place, and particularly our leadership in 5G puts us in a strong position in terms of competing and providing Australians the best possible experiences and then ultimately our shareholders the best long-term returns.
Okay, we're right on time there, ladies and gentlemen. Once more, joining me with me saying thank you to Vicki for a great overview of Telstra. Now, as we mentioned, we have a bonus for you today. There's an extra session which will run for the last 20 minutes of today. So just give everyone who needs to go 1 second. That's about three of you. That's really good because it's more than a bonus. It's an opportunity to have a look at an emerging trend on ASX. I mentioned at the outset a range of income funds have come to market. Metrics led those a couple of years back in 2017. I think we're about to hear from Justin Hine talking to us through about MOT, the second fund that Metrics has brought to the ASX. So join me in welcoming Justin for our last presentation.
Sorry, I'm... Yep, forward.
That one's forward.
Yep, okay.
The only one you need to worry about.
Yeah, okay. Thanks very much, Ian. Yep. Okay, thanks very much, everybody, for coming along. And I feel very special getting the pre-lunch slot. So my name's Justin Hynes. I'm one of the four managing partners at Metrics Credit Partners. We're a Sydney-based fund manager. We specialise in private debt and credit. In sort of layman's terms, that's lending. If you sort of think about what we do, we lend to companies and projects very much in the same manner that that the banks do. We manage a number of wholesale institutional funds. We've got about $5 billion of assets under management. That's all money lent to Australian companies and projects. And we also manage two listed investment trusts on the ASX. So we've got our recently IPO'd MOT, which is our Income Opportunities Trust, that IPO'd in April this year. And then for 18 months prior, we actually have a MCP Master Income Trust, which is a larger LIT. Both of those funds feed down into our wholesale funds, and it gives retail investors like yourselves the opportunity to invest effectively as a wholesale investor in alongside superannuation funds, insurance funds, high net worth individuals and family offices. So I guess as you're thinking about what we do, This is really delivering fixed income in a tradable form on the ASX. So I think when we first launched our Master Income Trust, it was quite revolutionary. You would have seen there's been quite a few, in particular of our offshore competitors, who've attempted to follow in our tracks. But I guess especially in a world now where people are searching for yield, the temptation is to take on more risk. Markets are quite volatile. This is actually a bit of a product for the times, and we're very proud of what we've achieved. So it's just sort of, the first slide is just effectively what I've just explained. $5 billion, we lend to a variety of different companies, and we participate in interbank markets. If you sort of look at the pictures, so we do corporate lending, so you recognise a lot of the ASX-listed names that we lend to. This is us as part of large bank syndicates, dominated by the domestic banks, but also a lot of offshore and international banks. Origin Energy, Ramsay Healthcare, Woolworths, Qantas, etc. We also lend to lots of large private companies. So this sort of, again, us together with the banks, effectively a large part of Australia's corporate economy. We do acquisition finance, so we'll back companies, provide them with the debt to acquire companies. So, for example, some of the public to privates you would have seen recently, like Healthscope, MYOB, we were part of the banking syndicates that backed the sponsors to acquire those businesses. We also lend to a lot of companies prior to IPOing, so for example, Link Administration, Spotless, some of those companies when they were in private equity hands, then IPO'd. We're also able to participate in the banking facilities once a business IPOs as well. We do commercial real estate, and all of this is really the types of lending that banks do. So real estate's a large consumer of bank capital. So industrial, we don't do much retail, just given the headwinds in that sector, but industrial, office, residential, and then we also do a lot of project finance. So some of the nation building projects that you'd be aware of lately, so the Northwest Rail subway, for example, there's a waste to power project that we funded over in Kwinana, over in Western Australia. The new stadium over in Perth, for example. So sponsors like Brookfield, etc., for example, they'll win a project. They'll look to build something, and then they'll look to the banks and ourselves to provide that funding. You'll recognise a lot of the types of companies and projects that we lend to. I guess when you sort of think of it from the perspective of holding units in our two listed investment trusts, you're basically getting a diversified exposure to effectively what sit on bank balance sheets. So as you would expect, banks, they're quite disciplined with the way they lend. They've got covenants controls. You're lending at the top of the capital structure. As a result, what you'll find in holding our units is a very stable net asset value. And then as all of our various borrowers pay their interest and then roll their loans, you get a nice income, so it's quite uncorrelated to a lot of the volatility that you'd be seeing through your public market portfolios. I won't spend much time on this slide, but I think Australia has always struggled. We don't really have a functioning corporate bond market. A lot of the bigger companies will get their fixed income by issuing into the European and US markets. They're deep and liquid. But Australia really is a mid-market sized economy, and the banks dominate the provision of debt capital. So if you look at the A-dollar corporate loans, effectively they provide, you know, three quarters of the corporate debt that companies provide. So, for example, where Vicki was referring to the credit metrics and the borrowings and in the early presentation, that would be provided by, I mean, Telstra also have bonds, but also by banks as part of bank syndicates. And, you know, the bank market is the go-to fixed income market in Australia. But I guess from a retail investor perspective, and even up until recently, from a super fund and insurance company's perspective, inaccessible. So I think we're quite proud with what we've achieved insofar as we've now aggregating capital and providing that debt capital alongside banks in an interbank market and effectively providing access to an otherwise inaccessible market to retail investors on the ASX. Just with regards to the features of loans and then how this behaves in your portfolio. So loans themselves are actually priced off the bank bill rate, which is strongly correlated to the RBA cash rate. So I apologise, we haven't updated this slide, but obviously the RBA rate is quite low at the moment, but you will see there's always a nice spread over the top of the bank bill rate, and that's effectively the bank's cost of funding and their profitability. So I guess heading into a low interest rate environment, you'll find that our market sort of has a floor, if you like, so that cash yield doesn't get compressed to the extent that if inflation were to ever occur in the future, these are floating rate instruments, they're short, and they go up with inflation and the bank bill rate as well. As you would expect, loss rates are very low. Loans sit on bank balance sheets, they're tightly controlled, and it's obviously a regulated market, so our funds enjoy the benefit of that as well. I guess if you look at this, this is where we lend in the capital structure of a company. So if you think simplistically, who provides capital to companies to build things or to optimise their capital structure? You've got debt and you've got equity and different shades of it. So our funds, we lend the senior debt, so you're at the top of the capital stack. We're not in the business of running companies or building projects, so we will provide capital. It'll be tightly controlled, and to the extent that you know, an owner or a sponsor needs to, you know, support that investment over time, then they will manage that investment. To the extent that the business is trading off, you have covenants and controls and triggers to sit down with the company or the project developer and discuss with them how they're going to, you know, work their way through it. So what you actually find is from a risk perspective, it's actually a very low risk asset class. This sort of explains in a nutshell how we actually provide to an ASX investor fixed income on the ASX, if you like. So we've got two listed vehicles. There's the Master Income Trust, which has been on the market for about 18 months, and then the High Yielding Income Opportunities Trust. Effectively, they are feeder funds, so they're feeding down into our underlying funds that invest across the credit spectrum, together with super funds and insurance companies and other institutional investors. So effectively, you are investing almost as a wholesale investor alongside those investors, and everybody enjoys the scale to then act and behave like a bank balance sheet. So you can see there our target return, which we've overachieved for the Master Income Trust, the RBA plus 325, so 4.25% per annum. I think we're up sort of around 5. That is cash income getting paid monthly. So if you sort of think about what floating rate fixed income should do, it's a nice, stable source of cash, and the actual asset base itself doesn't get knocked around by public markets. You can see the income opportunities trust feeds into our higher yielding trusts. So therefore the return is higher, and there is also a little bit of equity upside there. So we're finding that in some markets you're actually able to get better returns out of the debt than the equity. So this sort of visualises what we've achieved. So if you think about government bonds on the left and traditional fixed income on the left, it's very low risk, low return. Really what sits through the middle of the credit spectrum there is what sits on bank balance sheets, pushing right up into equity, which is in the top right-hand corner there, high risk and high return and high volatility. And you can see that as it trades through the cycle. Effectively, MXT is our master income trust investing in those three underlying funds. The opportunities trust yielding in the higher risk return, and what that is delivering to an investor on the ASX are those two return streams. So you'll see the top, the NAV per unit, effectively that is the sum of 120 odd loans on a look-through basis, the interest accrues, and then we pay income monthly. Your NAV goes back to the $2 NAV, and you can see obviously there's investor demand, it's not traded at a discount. We've gone back twice to the market, which is where you get the declines there, but there's obviously strong public demand for fixed income, which has been historically underallocated. Our higher returning income opportunities trust there, it's only sort of listed in the last few months, so we paid our first distribution the end of June. That is currently running at a yield of almost 8%. So in terms of bringing fixed income to the ASX and providing an access to an asset class that is otherwise sits on bank balance sheet, we're quite proud of what we've achieved. We think it's been quite revolutionary. So I think with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Yep, we have time for a couple of questions, Justin, from the audience. I'll go up this side.
Yeah, thanks for the presentation. With your higher income return trust, does that involve mezzanine lending and, let's say, development finance?
Yeah, so the higher yielding trust will do subordinated lending. The development piece, it can be higher risk or lower risk. So so to answer your question, yes, it does. But also it's you're basically lending into a, you know, like, for example, a development that we will, you know, fund into. You're sort of lending at, you know, say a 60 or a 65% loan-to-value ratio based on valuations that reflect the current lending environment. You may be lending alongside a NAB or an ANZ on a senior basis, on a cost-to-complete basis, which is something we would do in our more investment-grade funds. So we participate across the credit spectrum, but also... you know, I think when you're lending and you're junior to banks, you also need to be confident that if there are issues, you need to be able to control the situation. So we're more flexible than a bank, so we can actually proactively manage risk in those circumstances, including taking control of the company or utilising more capital to make sure, for example, a project gets built so that you've got final stock to sell, or... you know, a business gets taken over, you might need to replace the management, etc. So it's very much working with companies and projects through the cycle. But to answer your question, we do. That's where you're getting the high yield in that higher risk LIT.
Okay, thanks, Justin. Do you have, there's one in the middle here, Gemma, if you can get the microphone to the gentleman.
Thank you for the presentation. I'm a recent investor in MXT, so I'm sort of watching it very carefully.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah.
Yes, and I was just sort of wondering if you can explain the reason for the swing around in the share price. You can sort of see shortly after it listed it, sort of went down to the NAV and then it increased and then went down to the NAV. Is there some sort of underlying logic with that?
No, it's actually just when we announced to the market that we were doing entitlement offers. So we initially IPO'd at 730 odd million. We came back to the market, which is where the first drop was, to issue another 200 and a little bit. It's a large scalable market, so you know, this is $100 billion a year. You're competing with banks, so we will always want capital. So that was the first drop. You would think following an entitlement offer, everyone would be happy, but then it traded to a premium again, and then again, the same thing happened again. But I guess importantly also, you know, it's not traded at a discount. And whilst if you were to purchase at a premium, the actual yield you're getting is a little bit less than if you came in at an entitlement offer. It's still quite attractive, you know, when you compare it to obviously different risk, but for example, term deposits on one end or hybrids or high yielding equities on the other side. So, you know, if you had participated in the IPO and you still held the units, your returns would be effectively just that NAV per unit. You'd be have chugged along for the last X, you know, months or years, generating a nice 5% yield off off some pretty safe lending books.
Okay, we have time for one more. Yeah, right at the very back, Gemma, it's almost on your way out.
Yeah, with MOT, you seem to have very meticulously avoided putting up the usual histogram of the credit quality of the individual loans.
Yeah.
Because that's when you do that, it's not very good, is it? I mean, there's a big difference in risk between MOT and MXT. They are very different.
Yeah, I look, basically, MOT, I would say, so MXT, I would say, is two-thirds what you would call investment grade, one-third sub-investment grade. MOT would be probably three-quarters sub-investment grade and a quarter investment grade insofar as you have lots of asset collateral over cover. I think suffice to say, MOT in particular, that was actually originally pitched. People pulling, you know, if you think equity is where it is, it's actually not a bad alternative for equities to the extent that you can generate an 8 to 10% target return over time out of, you know, part of a capital structure that still has equity sitting behind you. And I think, you know, suffice to say, is where we lend at the more pointy end is generally with, you know, the more capable private equity firms, the larger public and private developers. These are professional, you know, operations. You're not sort of lending at the small end of town, so it's pretty well controlled risk.
Okay, well, we're right on time, so let's say thank you to Justin for an insight to metrics. And I've just got a few housekeeping things to do. Thank you, Justin. A couple of reminders. As you may have heard at the outset, all of the presentations today have been recorded, so there's a video. All of the presentations are on PowerPoint, so there's a copy of everything you've seen here today, as well as some interviews. So as each of the presenters leave here, they're interviewed by our partners at nabtrade. And each one of those pieces will be on the ASX website under education, finance, webinars, and the event probably where you registered to come along here as well. So you'll be able to go to the ASX and see a copy of everything you've seen today by way of video, review it as you've seen through the presentations each that have been made here today, and actually get an insight into the interview that's occurring as we speak as the presenters leave. So too, if you're a nabtrade customer, that's available through nabtrade. So plenty more review and opportunity to go back. In fact, I was somewhat flattered at the outset when I saw people taking photos. I thought it was of me, but it really was of the slides. You didn't have to do that because you can get the whole thing for yourself. Also, if you haven't registered, you may be interested in knowing on Thursday week, ASX is again running the second
small mid-cap session over at the International Convention Centre. I think it attracted a very large audience of over 500 people last year. I think the reservations and the registrations are filling out fast. So if you're looking for more insight in a little bit more detail than perhaps you might have heard today about certain companies, here's another way for you to do that as well. I think our next CEO Connect session is in October, so if you're a regular attendee and you haven't already done so, please block out the 15th of October to be back in this room. Now, the reason you haven't all stayed, because of the really great presentations, and even the gentleman at the back who lost his ticket, he signed a stat deck through with ASX compliance to say, yes, I lost it genuinely, I've got a new ticket issued, I've only got one ticket in my pocket. You have to be in the room to win this. It's all by numbers. Now, trust me, look, nothing up the sleeves. I'm a retired ASX employee. I have one. Oops. Is number S, a blue ticket, S05. No. This time it's a red ticket, N22. At the back of the room, congratulations. Thank you, sir. You are now the proud winner of a Visa gift card for $150. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. I hope you found the sessions entertaining and useful. We look forward to seeing you next time the ASX runs such a similar session, if not on Thursday week at the ICC. Good afternoon, enjoy your day.